أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن حي على السلام حي على السلام حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح
نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح لهذه الأمة وجاهد في الله تعالى حق جهاده حتى توفاه الله فصلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم تسليما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد، فيقول الإمام البخاري رحمه الله تعالى في جامعه الصحيح: حدثنا أبو عاصم الضحاك بن مخلد قال أخبرنا الأوزاعي قال حدثنا حسن بن عطية عن أبي كبشة عن عبد الله بن عمرو رضي الله تعالى عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم قال: بلغوا عني ولو آية وحدثوا عن بني إسرائيل ولا حرج، ومن كذب علي متعمدا فليتبوأ مقعده من النار. أو بهذا المعنى: the great companion of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, Allah be pleased with both of them, reported that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the following words. And look at the beauty of this hadith and the concise yet comprehensive nature of this hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً وحدثوا عن بني إسرائيل ولا حرج، ومن كذب علي متعمدا فليتبوأ مقعده من النار. We can take this hadith and we can break it down, we can dissect it into three main sections, three main parts, three main components. Number one, بلغوا عني ولو آية. Spread the message, convey the message, teach people, tell people, pass on my legacy, ولو آيةً. Even if you only have one sentence, even if you only know one thing, even if you can only grasp a little bit in a small piece, بلغوا عني ولو آيةً. Piece number one. Number two, وحدثوا عن بني إسرائيل ولا حرج. And there is no sin, there is no problem, there should be no hesitation, there is no worry or no stress that you should have with regards to telling stories and narrations of the previous people, such as the Israelites. There's no sin in talking about what's mentioned in this book and that book. What they said about Musa and Isa and their followers and his disciples. حدث عن بني إسرائيل ولا حرج. There's no sin, there's no worry, and there should be no hesitation
and you telling the stories that have been passed down. Last but not least, the third compartment of this beautiful hadith, وَمَنْ كَذَبَ عَلَيَّ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَلْيَتَبَوَّأْ مَقْعَدُ مِنَ النَّارِ. And as far as those who make up lies against me, as far as those who intentionally are concerning what I said and what I allowed, what is my deen, my way, my legislature, my religion, those who make things up against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, regardless of their intention, regardless of their reason, I want to guide people, so I made up a hadith. I want to please the non-Muslims who are attacking Islam, so I made up a rule in Islam. It's okay, Muslims are allowed to do this. Regardless of your intention, or if you wanted to mislead people intentionally, whoever lies against me intentionally, then he should take his seat in the fire of hell. So one hadith in Sahih Bukhari has three main sections. Pay close attention. Hear me now. Hear me now. Piece number one, balighu, is that you have to give da'wah. You have to convey the message. You have to spread the message. Whether you're a great scholar or whether you're a basic, simple 9-to-5 cab driver. Number two, your style of da'wah, how you give da'wah, to whom you give da'wah, your way, your manner is unrestricted. وَحَدِّثُ عَنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ وَلَا حَرَجٍ. If you wish to talk about the Qur'an, that's fine. You want to talk about the hadith, that's fine. You want to call people to Islam through Christianity, through Judaism, through this story. You want to remind them of what's in their own books that's confirmed in the Qur'an, لَا حَرَجٍ. There's no sin in that. But last but not least, be accurate. Be precise. Don't mess things up. Don't mix things up. Don't confuse concepts and realities. Don't be sloppy when you call to al-Islam. And we all know the tremendous virtue of giving da'wah to Allah. And we all know the obligation of conveying from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we all know that we as Muslims believe in the previous scriptures. We believe in Musa, Moses. We believe in him as a prophet, as a chosen servant of God Almighty. We believe in that. And we believe in Isa, or Jesus, or Christ, and his miraculous conception, and his miraculous birth. And we believe in many, many things that others who love Christ and unfortunately worship him believe in as well. That's not a problem. That's not an issue. We all know that. Last but not least, we know the severity of lying in Islam. And that is a major sin. And we know the tremendous gravity or gravity of lying upon Allah and or lying upon the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So those are the three main parts of this hadith. And if you look at this hadith, it's utterly beautiful. And everyone can take something from it. بَلِّغُ عَنِّي. Pass on the message. وَلَوْ آيَةً. Even if it's one sentence. One hadith. That's all I know. I don't know more. I haven't memorized more. But you have a duty of conveying. Number two. وَحَدِّثُ عَنْ بَنَاءِ إِسْرَائِيلَ وَلَا حَرَجَ. I'm a talker. I'm a writer. I'm an author. I give da'wah through my actions. I give da'wah through charity. I give da'wah through community work. La haraj, no problem with that. Last but not least, never ever misrepresent Allah. And never ever misrepresent the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through your speech and or through your actions. So what I want to focus on and highlight regarding this authentic hadith is point number two. وَحَدِّثُ عَنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ وَلَا حَرَجَ. Narrate from the Israelites and there's no sin in that. The Quran, when you open it up, and when you read it, there lies no doubt. You'll find an abundance of stories of the previous nations. And you'll find an abundance, not a little bit here or there, a few passages. You'll find surahs, verses, whole entire paragraphs from surahs that talk about Bani Israel. Rather, on the contrary, Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us, and we memorize it, and we repeat it, is that Allah gave Bani Israel something that he gave no one else. وَأَنِّي فَضَّلْتُكُمْ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ. I gave you something that no one else had ever received from me. The great prophets, the great messengers that came from the line, that came from the house, that came from the offspring, that came from the tradition and the legacy, the posterity, the progeny of Bani Israel. Most of them, or a large number of them. So there's no doubt about that. And from that is Musa and Isa, and then we have the other prophets and the other messengers. But there is a man who is not a prophet. And there's a man who is not a messenger. is a man who was from Bani Israel, who had a very miraculous story, a very important story that is not mentioned in the Quran. But the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam generously tells us about this man. And he was from Bani Israel. And bi-idhnillahi ta'ala is what we're going to talk about in the next khutbah, the second khutbah. After I invoke Allah, and after you invoke Allah for His forgiveness, for His mercy, and perhaps you will invoke Allah Azza wa Jal during Sa'atul Ijabah. The time, period, the hour, the slot of time in which Allah Azza wa Jal is asked for something and He does not say no. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله تعالى لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى وصلاة الله وسلامه على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد. This man's name, maybe you've heard of him, maybe you haven't. His name was Jurayj. Jurayj. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us about this man whose name was Jurayj by saying لم يتكلم في المهدي إلا ثلاثة. Is that there were only three babies, three children, three infants, three newborns who spoke in the crib. Something so phenomenal, so paranormal, so outstanding, so beyond which is ordinary that it only happened three times. Even though there are other times in which children spoke, young children, but not in the cradle, except for three. And from those children, or those babies, or those infants, or those newborns that spoke in the cradle, was a young child, a young boy. And look at the beauty of this story that I want to narrate to you, and look at the similarities and the parallels between him and between Isa. One of the main focal points of Banu Israel and the story of the Israelites and Musa and so forth. And Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he spoke when he was a young, small, tender baby. For what purpose? That's the same purpose that this young boy spoke. And that was to declare that the one who's being accused and attacked and slandered is innocent. So Jurayj, may Allah have mercy upon him, he was a righteous man, a holy man, as they say. He was a man of piety and utmost religious devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he had a temple. He had a soma'ah. He had a place where we would call a masjid. A place that was made for his worship and which he would remove himself from worldly distractions. Like an i'tikaf. You make the i'tikaf, you cut off your phone, airplane mode, do not disturb, or you even better, you turn it off. Wife, children, husband, friend, family, sports, playoffs, I'm in i'tikaf. Khalas. Please don't bother me. This is my spiritual retreat. It's my spiritual vacation. And I don't wish to be disturbed. So Jurayj, may Allah have mercy upon him, as is in Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, narrated by Abu Hurairah and others, he was offering prayer one day. فَجَاءَتْهُ أُمُّهُ فَدَعَتْهُ. So he was offering the prayer, and all of a sudden, entering upon his temple and his private spiritual space was his mother. And his mother, she called him, فَدَعَتْهُ فَلَنْ يُجِبْهَا. She called out to him, oh Jurayj, oh son, I need you to prepare me a meal. I need you to milk the cow or the goat. I need you to help me boil some water. I need you for something. And Jurayj, he didn't answer his mother. Rather, he continued to offer the prayer. How did Banu Israel pray? Did they face the Kaaba? Did they make four raka'at, two raka'at? Did they make ruku, etc.? The specifics of their prayer was not like, or is not like the specifics of our prayer, but there was salah. And they only prayed to Allah. They had tawheed. So as he offered the prayer, and he continued to pray, his mother called him again. Ya Jurayj, oh son, I need you. And Jurayj was confused. He didn't know what to do. He had a hard time prioritizing. What should I do? Salati, my prayer, or ummi, or my mother? He didn't know what to do. So Jurayj, he thought, and he felt, that he needed to prioritize his prayer to Allah. And he did not respond to his mother. And his mother became angry. And his mother became upset. His mother became impulsive. And she made dua against her son for not responding to her. And not respecting her, how she needed to be respected. and not prioritizing that which needed to be prioritized. And she made a very harsh dua against him. And she said, Allahumma la tumithu hatta turiyahu wujuh al-mumisat. She says, oh Allah, don't give my son death. Do not allow him to die until he stares in the faces of prostitute women. Do not allow my son to leave this world until he has a face-to-face confrontation with women who are unchaste, with women who are harlots. Do not allow him to die, O Allah, until he sees these women and confronts these women. And we all know the importance of the dua of the parents in Al-Islam. However, it does not mean that it is to be abused, like many of you shamelessly do. Many of you shamelessly abuse this concept. And if your son doesn't obey you in everything, and if you cannot micromanage his life and tell him what to do from A to Z, and if your daughter does not obey you in haram and do what you want to do and chase and follow the dunya like you want to, then you'll say, I'll make dua against you, daughter. I'll make dua against you, son. I'm going to pray against you if you go overseas. I'm going to pray against you if you get married. I'm going to make dua against you if you want to be religious. If you cover your face, I'm going to make dua against you. If you pursue the deed better than us, I'm going to make dua against you. That's not how it works. You don't have the key to Allah's mercy in your palms. How do you know your dua is accepted? How do you know someone's not making dua against you for being a bad parent? How do you know someone isn't making a dua against you for not praying? Who told you that you can just call upon Allah and your son or your daughter is ruined? For what? For haram? For disobedience? Because they didn't listen to you and something in which they had to listen to you, like your age? No! Because the son wants to study the deen. Because your daughter wants to get married before she finishes her law degree or engineering degree. So I'm going to make dua against you. Look at our attitude towards Allah. Our dua is accepted when we want to, how we want to. It's pitiful. And it's a shameless act that many Muslim parents do. However, the Prophet ﷺ does say, رِضَ اللَّهِ فِي رِضَ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَسَخَطُ اللَّهِ فِي سَخَطِ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. Allah's good pleasure is in the good pleasure of the parents. And Allah's anger and wrath is in the anger and the wrath of the parents. That's true. That's factual. But it doesn't mean that you control Allah and that you can monopolize Allah. It doesn't mean that. You are sinful yourself. You barely practice the religion yourself. What makes you think that you can raise your hands and just destroy your children for trying to be more religious? It doesn't work like that. And many Muslims, they have this ignorant attitude when it comes to dua. And many parents, they think that their children have to obey them in every single thing. And they feel that they have the ability to micromanage the life of a grown man or a grown woman. That is not Islam. That is bad culture. If you raise a man, why do you need to micromanage him? If you raise a woman, why do you need to control everything that she needs to do? But naturality is a manifestation of your bad parenting. Whereas you didn't raise a man, you raised a boy. You raised a boy that can't make decisions himself. You raised a boy that's foolish and stupid and impulsive. You did not raise a man that has hikmah, wisdom. You did not raise a woman that's responsible. Rather, you spoiled and pampered a child, and when they have their own desires, and they want to do what they want to do, then you say, I'll make dua against you, and paradise is under the feet of mothers. Shame upon you. Woe to you. Woe to you, and shame upon you. If you didn't do the right thing with your child, now is the time to start doing the right thing. Not to continue doing the wrong thing. So back to the story. Jurayj, he didn't respond to his mother, and she got angry, she got mad, and she made dua against him. And then came a woman. And Sahih Muslim, not in Sahih Bukhari, the version of the hadith says, يُضْرَبُ لَهَا الْمَثَلُ فِي الْجَمَالِ أو بِهَذَا الْمَعْنَى. Is that this woman was so beautiful, is that whenever the people talked about beauty, whenever they made a reference towards beauty, they would talk about her. Like we say, if you looked up lazy in the dictionary, you see a picture of yourself. That's what we say in English, right? If you looked up strong, you would see a picture of yourself in the dictionary. يُضْرَبُ لَهَا الْمَثَلُ. Is that she was so beautiful, is that the people compared, or they made her the standard of beauty. And she spoke to evil men who didn't like Jurayj. Perhaps they envied him, perhaps they were jealous of him, Allahu A'lam. And she says, إِنْ شِئْتُمْ لَأَفْتِنَنَّهُ أَوْ لَفَتَنْتُهُ. She says, if you want, then I can approach Jurayj, and I can make a scandal with Judaism, and I can try to seduce him and entice him, and I can destroy his name and destroy his reputation. So the woman, she approached Judaism, she came to Judaism, and of course Judaism, being a pious man, a righteous man, a holy man, he said, look, just like Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, who was so handsome, who was so young, and who was a stranger in Egypt. He wasn't from that land. They didn't know him. He didn't know him. He was a slave. And a beautiful, powerful, influential woman approached him. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says about the seven types of people who shall receive Allah's shade on the day in which there's no shade except for Allah's shade. And from them, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, وَرَجُلٌ دَعَتُمْ رَعَةٌ ذَاتُ مَنْصَبٍ وَجَمَالٍ فَقَالَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ يَعْنِي قَالَ لَا أَنْتَنَعْ مِنْهَا. A person who will receive shade on the day of judgment is a man who is seduced and enticed and called and invited by a beautiful, powerful woman. Two things now. Not only is she beautiful, but she's powerful. She's not of the peasantry. She's of the aristocratic stock. This is the prince's daughter, the king's daughter. She's a princess. She's a powerful, influential woman. And she wants you. And then you say, no, thank you, because I fear Allah. Not that you're unattractive, and not that I'm not a man and I don't have desires. No, that's not the reason, as many people think and feel, that it's wrong to have desires. That's not the reason why the man refused the woman. He did not say, you're not attractive and I'm not a man. But the only thing that prevented him from her was, إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهَ. I'm afraid of Allah. That's it. And Allah tells us by Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, وَلَقَدْ هَمَّتْ بِهِ وَهَمَّ بِهَا لَوْلَا أَرْعَى بُرْهَانَ رَبِّهِ. Indeed, she thought about him. Rather, she did more than think about him. She fantasized about him. She dreamed about him. And she was obsessed with Yusuf. وَهَمَّ بِهَا. And he indeed thought about her, at least to say. لَوْلَا أَرْعَى بُرْهَانَ رَبِّهِ. And the only thing that stopped Yusuf was him thinking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Judaism said no to the woman. And obviously afterwards, the woman she conceived. Obviously not from Judaism, through one of her clients, through her lover, through another man. She got pregnant. And she claimed and she said that Judaism is the father of my child. Judaism is a hypocrite. He's not a true pious man. And he doesn't practice what he preaches, Allahu Musta'an. Rather, he slept with me. He committed fornication with me. And then I had his baby. And this is the proof. So obviously the people, this is the highlighting point, the general mass of people, the ignorant people, the 9 to 5 people, the follow-along people, they immediately believed the whore. They immediately took her side. They didn't make an excuse for Judaism. She's lying. Bring the proof. Bring the evidence. What we know about him all of these years, they immediately took her side. And then they went out as an angry mob. And they took their axes and hammers and sticks and stones and they destroyed Judaism's temple. They knocked it down. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by his power and his omnipotence, his qudra and his quwwah and his izzah, that Allah has promised, inna Allah, Allah defends those who believe. Allah supports those who believe. Alaysa Allahu bikafin abdahu. Is Allah not sufficient for his servant? Allah kept his promise. Allah supported Judaism and he allowed the young child to speak and said that Judaism is not my father. That's a lie, that's a scandal, it's a conspiracy. He is not my father. Of course the people, their mouths open up, their jaws hit the ground, they were amazed, they were shocked. And the child pointed and said, who was the father of that child? And then he apologized to Judaism. They said, we're sorry. We'll give you a new temple. Nabni sama'ataka min dhahabin. He says, instead we'll build you a golden temple as a means of reparation or indemnity for what we have done to you. And look at the humility of Judaism and the humbleness of Judaism. He said, la illa min al-qin. He says, only build it back like it was out of clay. That's it. Mud bricks is more than enough for me. So this story shows us many things, brothers and sisters. The first thing that this story shows us is that righteous people, pious people, won't necessarily escape slander. Just because you're pious and righteous, it doesn't mean that you won't be slandered. And it does not mean that people will not make things up against you. It does not mean that people won't make accusations against you. No matter how stupid or foolish or immature or inaccurate the accusation may be. But it does not mean that you won't be touched. just because you're righteous and pious. And many righteous and pious people, may Allah make us from them. When trials take place, people say bad things about them. People lie against them, slander them. They get mad. They get upset. And they feel like, I don't deserve this. Why has this happened to me? How could so-and-so say this about me? Astaghfirullah. What's wrong with that brother? What's wrong with that sister? Don't take it so personal. There are people who are more righteous than you, closer to Allah, that went through more accusations than you did. So you should take it as a means of blessing. You should take it as a good thing. لا تحسبوه شر لكم بل هو خير لكم. Allah says, don't think it's a bad thing for you. Instead, it is a good thing that someone is lying and slandering and talking about you. So this man was in his temple, minding his own business, offering prayer, and that unchaste woman came to him and then made a lie against him. So that's point number one. Is that just because you're righteous, it doesn't mean that you're going to be unscathed. Don't be so foolish and immature. Allah will test you, and Allah will send people to test you. Number two, this beautiful hadith and this beautiful story, it shows us the importance and the status of the mother in our Islam. And that you should give your mother the utmost respect. And you should listen to her whenever you can. And the only time you're allowed to disobey your mother and not listen to your mother, if your mother tells you to do haram. And if your mother tries to force upon you haram. Or if you're in the middle of obligatory worship. As far as recommended worship, extra worship, voluntary worship, you must stop your prayers, stop your hajj, stop whatever you're doing that's voluntary to serve your mother. And no mother, no woman in her right mind would get her son to stop worship unless it was a necessity, unless it was an important thing, unlike abusive parents, as we said, who wish to control and dominate things that Allah has not given them. But a parent in their right state of mind, they're not going to call you. They're not going to message you. They're not going to interrupt and disturb your worship unless it's an emergency. So if you're making any extra prayer or extra in or extra class, your mother texts you, your mother calls you, your mother demands your service, it is upon you to stop. Number three, this hadith shows us the severity of the dua of the parent. Number four, this hadith shows us is that you don't have to worry. Don't stress. Don't allow yourself to be taken over by anxiety. Leave it up to Allah. Let Allah handle it. Let Allah take care of it. You just do your duty. You make sure that you're doing the right thing. You make sure that you're righteous and Allah will clear your name. Allah will show the people what's right and what's wrong. Don't worry about the people, but worry about the creator of the people. Don't busy yourself with people think and feel. Busy yourself with the maker of those people. Another very important point for this hadith, it shows us how people can be easily swayed and controlled by propaganda, by media, by the news, by scandal, by a lie, by a piece of gossip. And it shows you how fragile people can be. And how oftentimes you think someone is your friend, but in actuality they're not your friends. Oftentimes you think that a person likes you and loves you, but all it takes is a snap of the finger and a person hates you and they'll turn against you. We call them frenemies. They smile in your face. They shake your hand. How you doing, brother? How you doing, Sheikh? MashaAllah. Alhamdulillah. Tabarakallah. And all it takes is the smallest, simplest, tiniest thing to take place. And they start talking about you like a dog. And spreading bad rumors about you. And they start puffing and inflating the flame with oxygen and fire. Jurayj was a worshiper. Why would he be with this whore woman? He was in his temple. What was the whore woman doing in his temple? Did they think about that? Why was she in his place of worship? And if Jurayj was that weak, why would he desecrate his holy station? Why would he sleep with a woman in his place? They didn't even think. Rather, they took what this woman said, who was a sinful woman, at the least we can say about her. Her testimony was not supposed to be accepted, and they impulsively destroyed his property. So this is an extremely important lesson when it comes to life in 2021. In the United States, in Canada, the UK, when it comes to COVID-19, when it comes to Sheikh Fulan, and Brother Fulan, and Sister Fulan, and this one and that one, don't run to the scandal. Don't rush to the scandal. Don't take everything for face value. Don't immediately listen to the propaganda that you hear. just like Musa and Khidr. How could you kill the boy? How could you scum the ship? How could you not? How could you? Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, at that point, his understanding was still on the surface. And Khidr had something that Musa did not. And of course, Musa was better than Khidr. Of course. Musa was Kareem al-Ahmad. He was one of the greatest prophets and greatest messengers. And Khidr was a prophet. He wasn't a wali, but he was a nabi. But he was inferior to Musa. But in those specific things, he had more knowledge than Musa. And Musa's understanding was just scratching the surface. How could you kill the young boy? And Khidr told Musa in 100 words, "You don't know that which I know." So never be upon the surface. Never take things always for face value. Never judge a book by its cover. Did you not hear this as a child? Never judge a book by its cover. And don't be foolish and listen to slander and gossip without investigating it yourself. I guarantee, and Allah knows best, if I had to bet money, and Allah knows best if gambling was permissible, 99% of the people who talk about a speaker or an Islamic scholar, and what he said was wrong, and his bid'ah, and he made a mistake, 99.9% of them did not listen to that person's speech. They didn't hear what he said. But they're taking second, third, fourth, fifth hand information from someone who's an enemy and someone who's envious. So how can you take the information of someone who doesn't like another person? Did he say that directly? Did you listen to the lecture? Did you listen to the whole lecture? Did you see? Did you hear? You didn't. Brother, you're just following gossip and following conspiracy, and that's not how we are supposed to be. Another very important lesson that we take from this hadith is that if you destroy someone's property, and if you lose someone's property, and you squander someone's wealth, it is upon you to repay them. And it is not upon you to say, "Masha'Allah," as many of us do. "Where's my book, ya akhi?" Say, "Masha'Allah. Masha'Allah, akhi, it's missing." No doubt it's Masha'Allah that it's missing, for sure. And it's also going to be Masha'Allah when you buy my book back and you give me my property that you destroyed. And many Muslims, no doubt, they think and they feel, just because things are decreed and it's covered and we're Muslims, we can abuse people. And we can steal their stuff, take their stuff, squander their stuff, and we don't have to, and that's incorrect. Last but not least, this hadith shows us the virtue and the superiority of humbleness. As the Prophet ﷺ told us in an authentic hadith, "Inna Allah ta'ala awha ilayya an tawadhu." Allah has told me and revealed to me, instructed and recommended to my followers to humble themselves. And the Prophet ﷺ tells us that whenever someone humbles themselves for Allah, Allah will raise him. The people may not accept it, they may not appreciate your humbleness, but Allah will raise you. And who are we doing it for? Am I doing it for you? Are you doing it for me? Are we doing it to please Allah, the Mighty and the Most High? So the story of Juraij, no doubt, is a great story, it's a tremendous story, and it's a very practical story. And I would advise each and every one of you to go back to the original source of the hadith, read the hadith word for word, sit down and ponder on what Allah did for this righteous, pious man that was put in the confrontation of that horrible, terrifying scandal. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to enlighten our minds and to open our hearts. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make our hearts expansive for the truth, soft for the truth, transparent for the truth, see-through for the truth. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make our hearts closed and tight for the falsehood. Ameen. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make our hearts hard and solid against falsehood. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to not allow our hearts to be see-through for the falsehood. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to allow us to reflect upon these words, reflect upon these stories. Wa subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamu ala al-mursaleen. Wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa aqim as-salah. الله أكبر الله أكبر.